try to go through a quick recording of the startups procedures out here. And give everybody a glimpse of what goes on out here. Let's see, let's look to the south. Okay. So the sync is just so that I'm, you know, closer without any lag time pointing at the sky. All right, so I'm going to open the hatch. It involves my restraint cords and my push stick. So up with the top hatch. And then the bottom hatch is more like a drawbridge. I just push it out and let the line out. My ropes are out of the way. Telescope. Remove all the eyepiece covers. Okay. Give everybody power. Get Rigel here on the screen is right there. The red line here on the screen is the meridian, so I'm in the west hemisphere as I'm doing setup. Scope is slewed. I'm going to move the dome. There we go. And dim some light here, just a bit. Now what I want to do is center Rigel in the firing scope. Doesn't have to be perfect, I just have to be to the point where the camera can see it. So I'm going to come over here now to the camera tab. I'm going to connect the camera. It says ready. And we're going to go to focus tools. 1 second, pictures, take photo. While that's doing its thing, I'm going to reduce the motor speed. So the picture only took a second, but the download takes about 6.5 seconds. And so that kills me with this camera. It's not as fast as my Canon. Went to a star party last night, and after 3 hours of setting up and futzing with it, I was finally about ready to take pictures, and then the clouds came. All right, so there's our star. We are going to push it to the center here. One more after this. I think that one's gonna do it. Canon just downloaded so much quicker. There you go. That's looking pretty good. So we're going to say enter on the controller to say it's centered. And I'm going to push a line to accept it. It gives me another star, Aldebaran. I'm going to hit enter. Similar deal. We'll use the finder scope. Center. Very close. Well, there it is. Okay, I'm going to change the speed. It doesn't rocket off the screen. Whoa, look at that. There you go. There is an alignment procedure where you use the camera and you track the path of a star like you just saw. You drive it off the left screen and you come back and it makes a V wedge. And through that method, you can determine whether you're aligned correctly or not. Fundamentally, you want to close that V down to a line. It is one method of polar alignment. Pressure down. Go a little longer for your press. We'll see what happens. If not, we'll accept it. Accept that. Enter. And the line. It asks for a calibration star, so I can go in and add additional stars. It just improves accuracy. It's rare that I do that. I have other ways to work around that. So I'm going to say back. And it says align successful. So at this point, the mount is calibrated to where I can use the hand controller and drive around the sky. The far farther you are away from these two alignment stars, the more error you're going to get. And if it flips to the other side of the meridian, let's say avoid that, if it goes from this side of the sky to this side of the sky, you got all the weight of the telescope going against the opposite, you know, gear backlash because it flips around. So you get a little bit of error when you do that as well. So there's a trick to that. But we're going to move on to focusing, because I had this camera off of here last night at the star party, and now it's back on, and it's in a different orientation. And basically, it's all about focus, focus, focus. So this is what I'm going to put on. It's a Bassinot mask. It just slips over the end of the telescope. Okay, I'm going to go back to taking a photo again. What this will do is, you'll see it on the screen, but it'll create a set of crosshairs, and then another third line that will vary as you change focus. So, here we go. So, I'm going to do a subframe here. There we go. So basically the subframe is just looking at a smaller area of the picture, which acts like a zoom. But that's that pattern that you see. Now I'm going to loosen the set screw on the focusing device. And I'm going to roll the focus knob. And we'll wait for it to refresh. Not in real time, see that one line. Probably at about the 1 o'clock position, it's moved off. And we'll roll back. A bit closer. I'm going to go to the fine adjustment knob. Not quite. A little more. Wait for it. That's looking pretty good right there. I don't think I'm going to play around anymore for the purposes of demonstration. I set the lock nut so it doesn't slip. Bumped it so it's blurred. Let's see. Continue on. Now that I look at it, it looks like it's overshot just a smidgen. Come back, lighten. See what that looks like. That's me because I touched the scope. Okay, that one looks a little better. So that's how you perform kind of a visual aid focusing without, you know, trying to say, well, is this smaller or bigger, because the star will get bigger and more bloated as it gets out of focus. But it's hard to determine when the circle gets to its smallest region or size. So that's that. We've just focused. Canceled that. I'm going to get out of that. But now, all that clicking you hear is my mouse on the keyboard desk. Telescope's been aligned, we have focused, I need to take off my mask before I forget. That can be an aw shucks, take a bunch of pictures and figure out you have your focusing mask on, which takes up half of your life. So alright, so here we go. We're going to say telescope, connect. Okay, and it hops over to where it thinks it is in the sky. We zoom, 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 zoom. Okay, this last star we went to is Aldebaran. So this is the target. This is where the system thinks it is. So what we want to do now is say star synchronization. Sync on Aldebaran. Boom. So now, basically, we've zeroed out at that position using the alignment that we put on the mount. So, I mean, everything will kind of grow from this point, error-wise. It's like our origin. So, what can we do tonight?